So I would not go into detail as we have expert to talk on the today's this subject. So I would like to invite CS Pradeep Chawlaji to start this session. Before that, I would like to introduce him. He is company secretary by profession and he is FCS, LLB, MCOM and trademark attorney. He is a fellow member of the Institute of Company Secretary of India, having then 10 years of experience into practice. He has been serving big enterprises and NRI clients for a decade. Primarily, he deals into core secretarial, legal and taxation related services. He is a young and dynamic member of the Institute. He believes in quality of services he delivers to his clients. So I would like to introduce CS Pradeep Chawlaji to start the session. Over to you, Pradeep ji.
Thank you so much. Good evening, friends. Thank you, Chandra ji, first of all, for always giving so much of regard. So, first of all, I'd like to give you my brief introduction. So, I am Pradeep Chawla. I am a fellow member of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India. So, I am a practicing company secretary and I have been into practice since last 10 years. I am operating from Delhi. I have two offices. And this was my initial introduction. So, the topic of today's webinar is the relaxation provided by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs due to the present situation, due to the pandemic, that is Corona, COVID-19. Because we all are aware that due to Corona, due to COVID-19, there are so many difficulties being faced by all the enterprises, by all the professionals in relation to the compliances, whether it relates to the TDS, it relates to ROC, BATS, income tax or whatever. So today we'll be discussing about the compliances which are related to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, that is the filing which are being done by the companies with ROC, the concerned ROC, where the registered office of the companies is registered. So we have a PPT, we'll be sharing the PPT wherein we have just mentioned certain points. So this is the PPT which we'll be discussing today. So this is related to the relaxation and the compliances by MCA. So the first point that is the part of this PPT is that the Ministry of Corporate Affairs has come up with a notification, that is a circular dated 24th of March 2020. So it has introduced a scheme called as CFSS scheme 2020, related to which the companies are allowed to file all the pending returns. So be it the annual return, be it a director change, appointment, resignation, or any other return. However, there is certain exceptions, but majorly all the forms, there are more than 50 forms which are covered therein. So companies are allowed to file all pending returns with the registrar of companies by 30th of September without any late fee. So friends, I would like to bring to your kind attention, first of all, that this relaxation is a very big relaxation in terms of helping to the companies or to the entities which were making default in filing their annual returns, financial statements, because we all are aware that as per a previous notification, companies like the ROC used to levy 100 rupees per day penalty from 1st of July 2018. But now as per this CFSS scheme, the companies which were in default of filing their financial statements, annual returns with ROC, which were supposed to be filed within 30 days or 60 days as like respectively, they are in a position to file their pending return with ROC without paying even a single rupee as an additional fees. But after availing the benefit of the scheme, they have to file a form that is called CFSS scheme form, which is not available on the portal now, which will be available after the scheme comes to an end. That is 30th September is the last date after which the form will be made available on the portal and the professionals and the entities may file it with the registrar of companies, confirming that what all forms, what all returns that have been filed and what all in like benefits that have been availed by the entities in respect of CFSS scheme. So we have prepared a very small questionnaire which will help you to understand on basis of this CFSS scheme that company, which company can take the benefit of this scheme. Any company. First of all, there is no bifurcation. Any company which is in default of any document return statement that can file with registrar of companies and can avail the benefit of the scheme. But there is an exception. The companies which have already been struck off, for example, the company has made a default in respect of annual return, or it has made a default of filing the financial statement with ROC for consecutive of period of 3 years. So the company would already have got stuck up and by the Registrar of Companies under Section 248 of the Companies Act 2013. In such a case, company will not be able to avail such scheme. Next to that is, if the company has already filed an application for getting the company to be struck off. For example, you have a company and you were not in a position to pay this much of penalty, because if you take 100 rupees penalty per day and you haven't filed the annual returns or financial statement for a consecutive period of 3 years or 4 years previously, so the total penalty, if I talk about it, will be in the lakhs. So now you are of opinion that you have filed an application. However, STK2 cannot be filed, but you have filed a physical application with the registrar, confirming that we are not desirable, like we are not willing to continue with the company and the company to be struck off. Or you have complied with the requirements. Now you have filed an application with the concerned ROC for getting the company to be struck off. Then you are not eligible for such scheme. Secondly, thirdly, if the company has already filed an amalgamation scheme or arrangement scheme with the concerned department. Friends, if you have filed an application for the arrangement or consolidation or the amalgamation of the companies, in such a case you are not eligible for such scheme. Or you have filed an application for getting the company's status to be dormant, in such a case you are not eligible for availing such scheme. You only need to file the return. If you are not falling in this criteria, you are eligible and you can avail the benefit of such scheme at the end of the scheme. When the scheme period is going to be ended, you only need to file the CFSS form, wherein you need to mention the SRN of all the returns that you have filed during that period. So we have attached here with we have mentioned here in the link in which you will get all the forms which are eligible to be filed within this period. Moving to the next slide. So next question is, what is the scheme? So the question is that this scheme is for the companies which are in default, as I have already explained. So the duration of the scheme is from 1st of April 2020 and it's going to be ended on 30th September 2020. Next question is, whether belated filing under the Companies Act 1956. Yes, the Companies Act 1956 returns which are pending, let's say the previously forms 23AC, wherein like AOC4 in new CAC is being filed, but previously 23AC, ACA used to be filed. So in case you haven't filed previously annual returns and the company is still active, then yes, you can avail the benefit of such scheme. Next to that is, what are forms returns can be filed under the scheme? Yes, AOC4 and NGT7. Yes, I had already explained that these are the annual returns and the financial statements form which are filed with Registrar of Companies every year. Like AOC4 is filed with Registrar of Companies within 30 days from the date of annual general meeting, and NGT7 is to be filed within 60 days. So there is a exception, which are like SH7 is for increasing the authorized capital. So if you have failed to file the form which is related to the authorized capital, no, you are not eligible for that. So what benefits? So next part is, you need to file it with the Registrar of Companies for availing the CFSS scheme. So exemption for the payment of additional tax, you don't need to pay any additional fees. Only the nominal fees, depending upon the authorized capital of the company, is to be paid by the company and the professional whosoever is filing it. And fee can be paid by any of the means. It can be paid through credit card, internet banking, or debit card, or whatever. And the next to that is prosecution, immunity from prosecution. Immunity from prosecution means, if you have failed to file the annual return, and there is a law that talks about that the company has to face certain prosecution, so you are eligible to get yourself rid of this prosecution as well. Next to that is DIR3 and active form. So we all are aware that every director holding DIN is required to file its KYC with the Registrar of Companies, and for this financial year, 31st March 2020, that has already passed. So everybody whosoever is holding DIN, he is supposed to file his DIN DIR3 KYC. for example, somebody is holding the DIR like DIN for last 3 to 4 years, but he is not filing his KYC from the date when it came into the force. So he can now, earlier there was a penalty of ₹5,000 in such a case if you have failed to file it. But now there is a relaxation for 5,000. You don't need to pay even a single penny. The form is free of cost, and the active form is for tagging the where the registered office of the company is situated. For active submission, you need to file the photographs of the registered office from outside and inside, having its director to be seated on in his cabin. So active submission was to be filed. It is annual compliance now, and the penalty of non-filing of active form within the stipulated time is 10,000. But 30th September is the last date. You can file it without any late. So these were the relaxation which are available as per CFSS scheme, and every company is eligible for this, and you can surely go ahead and file your all pending returns. And the companies, especially the companies which are not complying with the annual returns and financial statements related compliances, you are advised to definitely have a benefit of this scheme. So next to that is relaxation in holding the board meeting through video conferencing. So we all are aware that the companies run through the board of directors, and definitely the board of directors are required to have their meeting on a quarterly basis. So due to pandemic, due to this corona situation, everybody is very much concerned that he shouldn't be going out, and he has to either work from home or he should manage it in such a manner that he should not be in contact with the people. So Ministry of Corporate Affairs has come up with a relaxation in terms of this, providing relaxation to the company that company can conduct its board meeting through video conferencing. Video conferencing can be done through any mode, like it can be done through Zoom, it can be done through Skype or whatever. For there are certain matters which can be discussed in this meeting, and the matters that we are talking about are like adoption of annual financial statements, adoption of approval of board report, approval of prospectus, if the discussion is related to the amalgamation, merger, demerger, acquisition, takeover, or the company is related, like company, any discussion which is related to the board, that can be done through the board meeting that is being conducted through the video conferencing, provided that there is a quorum. Yes, you need to comply with the quorum requirement. Yes, if the meeting is being conducted in present, like in manual manner, but if somebody is interested to have the participation through video conferencing, he is eligible for that. And the company, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, has come up with that relaxation, and it will be considered as valid. So next to that is the new relaxation is being provided that the gap of two meetings can be 180 days. So first of all, I would like to bring it to your kind attention, the basic rule that will help you to understand that as per section 173 of the Companies Act, there is a need for having at least 120 days gap. If you are conducting a board meeting and you are going to conduct the next board meeting, so there should be a gap of, there shouldn't be a gap of more than 120 days. So due to this corona, there may be certain circumstances wherein directors are either not in a position to conduct the meeting through video conferencing also. So in such a case, what the company can do, the company will be in a default by for not conducting the meeting as per the law. So the Ministry of Corporate Affairs has come up with a new circular wherein company are advised and company have been given this relaxation that the meeting, the gap between the two meetings, which was earlier 120 days, now it can be done for 180 days, but it is not a relaxation that is given to the company forever. It is a one-time relaxation, and the relaxation is till only 30th June. And after that, the gap requirement, which was there as per the companies at 120 days, it will remain same. So based upon that, there are certain points which I'd like to brief to you all, that the last meeting, for example, there are certain illustrations. For example, if the last meeting held on 28th of 2020, so what shall be the next board meeting date? So agar last meeting 28th of Feb 2020 ko hai, so as per earlier act, the gap should have been 120 days, but now it can be 180 days because due to the corona, the relaxation has already been provided, so there is no need to worry about that you have made a default in respect of this. I will not be going into this illustration because these are for your help, so will take much of time, but would like to go to the next PPT that will help you to understand the max relaxation for provided by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. So it is relaxation provided by the ministry which is related to holding of EGM, AGM to video conferencing. So we all know that companies are required to conduct its annual general meeting within 6 months from the end of the financial year. So if the company is of opinion to conduct its board meeting or its AGM, or there is certain matters which are going to which require the immediate attention of the members, which require it immediate consent of the member, for which AGM cannot be conducted and you cannot wait till the AGM, then in such a case EGM has to be conducted. So for both the purposes, whether it's extraordinary general meeting or it's an annual general meeting, in both the cases you can conduct the same by calling the AGM or EGM as the case may be through video conferencing, and you don't need to wait till the corona comes to an end and you will be conducting your AGM. You will not be making a default, it will be considered as valid. For a smaller company, like it's a private limited company, closed held company, and two or three directors or two or three the same people are the shareholders of the company, so you can definitely conduct your AGM through video conferencing or EGM through video conferencing. So next is that holding of AGM till 30th of September. We all know that companies are required to conduct their AGM till 30th of September 2020. But this is for those companies of which the financial year ends on 31st of March 31st March. So as per the Companies Act 2013, the financial year definition says that the financial year will be started from 1st of April and it will be ending on 31st of March, where it is not a first financial year, obviously. So if the companies are not adopting, if the companies are not ending their financial year on 31st of March, and they are following their financial year which is matching with their either a subsidiary company or the holding company which is not there in India or somewhere else, and they have already been permitted by the concerned ROC. Because for that also you need to file an application with the concerned ROC for following such financial year. So if you are approved and you are following the financial year which being ended on 31st of December, so you need not to worry. You can conduct your AGM by 30th of September, which is 9 months from the end of the financial year. So you will not be considered, you will not be in a violation. You will be considered as valid and your AGM will also be considered as valid. So whatever filing, like if I talk about the annual filing, if I talk about the annual returns, if I talk about all other compliances which are to be done after the annual general meeting of the company, and your financial year ends on 31st March, but earlier it was supposed to be conducted on by 30th of June, but now you can conduct it by 30th of September, and the compliances will also be followed after this 30th September. You don't need to worry, you can comply with the rules as per the law. So next to that is relaxation of time for filing forms related to the creation and modification of charges. So next to that, definitely the Ministry of Corporate Affairs has come up, because the earlier relaxation in CFSS scheme, there was the exclusion and which was not being considered there. Now the Ministry of Corporate Affairs has come up with a new relaxation which is strongly for creation and modification of the charges. It is not for any other purposes only. So if you are in default of filing of creation of charges or modification of charges, then you don't need to worry, but there are certain exceptions and there are certain terms and conditions which you need to consider and you need to weather only on basis of which you will be filing this with the concerned registrar of companies. What are the applicability, what are those conditions, we'll be just going through. So let's take it one by one. So first is, what is applicability of this scheme? Yes, the applicability is only for filing CSG-1 and CSG-9. CSG-1 is for creation and satisfaction of the charges. And CSG-9 is for filing the creation of debentures and there is any change in relation to any existing charges which is related to the debentures only. So where the date of creation modification of charges is before 1st of March 2020, but the timeline for filing hasn't expired. So as per section 77, if your 120 days time hasn't been ended on 1st of March 2020, then yes, you are eligible to avail the benefit of such scheme. You can definitely go for it and you will not be, you don't need to pay any additional charges for that. So next to that is where the date of creation modification of charge falls on any date between 1st of March to 2020 to 30th September 2020. So both dates are inclusive. Then yes, if your charge creation filing due date or modification charge, in both the cases, if the due date falls within this gap, then definitely you are eligible to avail such scheme. So next to that, the query comes to that, is it applicable for satisfaction of the charge? We all know that for satisfaction of charge, CSG 4 is filed within 30 days from the date of satisfaction. So no, for satisfaction of charge, this scheme is not applicable. You are not eligible to avail this scheme where it relates to the satisfaction of charge. So next to that is whether the form CSG 1, CSG 9 can be filed if timeline for filing such forms has been expired prior to, yes, no. If the CSG 1, CSG 9, if the timeline has already been ended, 120 days timeline has already been ended from like on or before 1st of March 2020, then you are not eligible. Like this, there are certain more questions which are mentioned on the screen. So what I will do, I will just share this PPT and definitely will be entertaining certain questions and questions from all the participants, whosoever, and will be answering those queries. So related to this charge only, we have created this page. This is related to the creation and modification and what is the applicable fees and the cap which we're talking about, that 1st of March 2020, if 120 days time period hasn't expired or your due date is falling within this cap, that is 1st of March 20 to 30th September 2020, in both the cases, you don't need to worry and you are eligible to avail the benefit of such scheme. There are certain other relaxations which are like companies auditor report 2020. So we all know that companies are very much mandated for complying with the CARO, and every year, like you know, that CARO applicability comes to a different path, and there are certain changes. So the CARO applicability 2020, which was supposed to be applicable for 1920, now it's being applicable for 2020-21. For this year, the applicability has been further postponed. So additional 6 months have been granted to the newly incorporated company. So we all know that earlier what used to happen, the public companies were supposed to file the application for certificate of commencement of business. But the Companies Act 2013 came up with a new change that the companies are required to file the application with within 6 months, 180 days from the date of incorporation, confirming that whosoever is the shareholder, whosoever is the subscriber to memorandum and article of association, they need to pay whatever they have subscribed to the company's bank account. And once the subscription amount comes to the company's bank account, they need to file the certificate of commencement of business application with the concerned registrar of companies in prescribed form as per the law. So the addition, however, that period was 180 days. Now the additional time of 6 months have been granted to the newly incorporated company. So if the company is incorporated in this period, then 6 months has been extended. For the financial year 19-20, non-compliance of for every individual, there is a need for having around 182 days criteria in the country for having the residential status. So in this pandemic, maybe certain changes would have been done. Any director who would have gone for any business trip or personal trip or whatever, and they are not in a position to come back to the country, or maybe they are planning to go somewhere and they are not in a position to comply with this requirement, so they don't need to worry. And this non-compliance of residential status is not applicable for the financial year 2019-20. And this will not be considered for having the residential status to be provided. Next to that is corporate social responsibility. So we all know that the big corporates making good profits, like 5 crores or more, they are mandated for their contribution for the social purposes as per the Companies Act 2013. And we all know that due to this pandemic, there are many entities, there are many big corporates, they have been making the contribution to the PF, PM CARES, or they are in distribution of some sanitary products, or they are in distribution of some other food products or healthcare services, or any disaster management services they are providing to anybody, whosoever. Depending upon that, the CSR responsibility, the contribution they were mandated to make for the financial year 2019-20, the expenses on all such contributions, on all such activities, will be a part of this corporate social responsibility contribution, and definitely auditor will have to mention it in the financial statement, and it will be identified for the CSR contribution for the financial year 2019-20. There are certain other relaxation which are related to the reconciliation of share capital audit report. So that is a share capital reconciliation report is filed in PAS 6 on half yearly basis. So now the 60 days relaxation has been provided for filing this PAS 6. So if your September return is filed, like which is pending for 31st of March, so 60 more days have been provided. So if it is falling for 15th of July, so you don't need to worry. You have a time till 13th of September for filing such return. There are certain relaxation provided by the registrar, like Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and these are related to the relaxation in terms of reservation of names. So in case you are incorporating a new company, or you are changing the existing name of the company, and you have filed any form with the registrar of companies, and the status of such form is required for resubmission due to any discrepancy or due to non-providing any of the return or document which was mandated to be required to be attached with such application with the concerned ROC. So you don't need to worry. You can file it within a period of, like if I talk about the name reservation, 20 days time period has been extended. So you, if your company is under incorporation and the 30th June was the last, last date was for a company incorporation or an LLP incorporation, 90 days period is given. And if your date is within this period and 20 days beyond 30th of June will be provided to you. But in case of company's name change, the period for which it is provided, that is 60 days. But 60 days beyond 30th June 2020 will be provided in such a case. If your any of the application is under required resubmission, and if it is falling between 15th March 2020 to 30th March 2020, additional 15 days beyond 30th of June will be has been provided, and the companies have already filed the whatever document required by the concerned ROC. So these were the major relaxations provided. Further mention that these are not all the relaxation provided by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and we have included a very comprehensive and a very small part of the relaxation provided by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. There are certain relaxations provided by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs based upon which we'll be taking the another webinar mentioning, and we'll be explaining all such relaxation, and the members can take benefit out of it. Now I would like to request if any of the participant has any query, and they can surely get back to us in related to any point mentioned or any point related to the point that we have taken up in this PPT.
Thank you, Pradeep. Sir, are there any relaxations for LLP also?
Yes, there is like CFSS is for companies, and there is a relaxation called as LLP scheme, which is for limited liability partnership also, and they can also file their returns which are due either for 2 years or 3 years, and they can also avail the benefit.
Other than that, if you could briefly give us more relaxation that are provided for LLP, sir.
LLP, like I have just told you, that companies are supposed to file their annual returns. Similarly, in case of LLPs, the Form 11 and Form 8, that is annual compliance, or any other form that. So in such a case, the company LLP has made a default in respect of any of the form, any of the return, then yes, they can avail the benefit without paying any additional fees, and they don't need to file any prosecution as well. So the same benefits are provided to the LLPs too.
I have another question, sir, but that is not related to the relaxation, so I'll keep it for the last. I'll allow other members to ask questions if they have any.
Pradeep ji, I have one question. Can a company file its pending single returns for several years in a single go?
Yes, as I have already explained, that the companies which have made a default in respect of their annual returns, which have made a default in respect of financial statement submission with the concerned ROC, yes, they can comply with the pending returns, even if it is for 3 years, 4 years. However, for a consecutive period of 3 years, default will lead you to either strike off the company or the director's disqualification too. But if your company is active, directors are also active, then definitely in both the cases, you can surely go for the filing for returns with ROC for availing this benefit.
Thank you.
If any other member has any questions regarding this relaxations.
Hello. Yeah. Hi, Pradeep ji. It's Priyanka.
Yeah, Priyanka.
I have a question.
Please.
Actually, I am holding directorship in one company, and currently we have closed that company. So is it mandatory to file DIR-3 KYC? Because right now I'm not holding any directorship in any company.
Will you please come again, because you were not audible and you were just starting.
Actually, earlier I was holding a directorship in one company, but currently okay. we had closed it. So is it mandatory to file DIR-3 KYC?
No, it's not mandatory if you're of opinion to open another company in future, because every person, as I had told you, that whosoever is holding them, I hadn't mentioned that the person should be a director or company should be a running company. If you are holding then, and you are in a company and you want to run that company, then you should do. If you are of opinion that you will not be opening any company, you will not be appointed any director in any company in future, then there is no need.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
So what will be the conclusion? Your DIN will be deactivated. And whenever you feel like today, if you are just activating, you don't need to pay even a single penny. If you have the digital signature, you can do it free of cost. You only need to give your PAN, Aadhaar and passport if you have, based upon which you can comply with this. Otherwise, there is no mandate that you should comply with DIR-3 KYC every year.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Any other question? Pradeep ji, ek mera aur question. Does a company require to have its records where it conducts its annual general meeting or board meeting through conferencing?
Through video conferencing, are you talking about?
Yes.
Okay, so yes, there is a need to have the record if you are conducting your board meeting or annual general meeting, or it's the EGM. For the future records, you need to keep it in the record. Like, we are having this Zoom call, and we have a right and we have an option to record the same. So if you are conducting your board meeting or EGM, as the case may be, you need to have the records for future. Yes.
Because आजकल maximum meetings हैं वो e-conferencing के through ही हो रही हैं, इसलिए मैंने एक question पूछा आपसे।
नहीं, बिल्कुल ठीक है, और ये this is mandate that if the company's meeting is being conducted through video conferencing, because in case department comes up with a query that how you managed to have your booking as per the law. So you should have a proof that yes, we conducted the board meeting through video conferencing. Like in many of the companies we are handling, the directors are sitting abroad and they are having their meetings in they are having their companies running in India. So they just have their participation in the board meeting or the EGM through video conferencing. So we have that proof. It is mandate as per the law.
Perfect. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Anybody has any other questions? Pradeep ji, if you could kindly share some lights on 248, sir. Do you see any further relaxations in that or government granting any amnesty scheme?
So no, basically section 248 deals with striking of the company. If the company is not filing its annual return and annual compliance, like annual financial statement with ROC for a consecutive period of 3 years, and if the company has been struck off, if the company hasn't been struck off, TFSS scheme is for you only, sir. You can definitely take benefit of it. And if you are of opinion that you should, you want to close the company, you avail the benefit, pay whatever nominal fee. It's 300, 400 or 500 depending upon the authorized capital of the company. And you can file an application under 248 wide prescribed forms STK2. And if your company has already been struck off, in such a case, no scheme, this scheme is not applicable for you. You firstly need to get your company to be revived, for which you need to file an application with NCLT. And once your company is active, then only you can file pending return. If the scheme is active till then you can avail the benefit. Otherwise, you will have to pay whatever fee applicable at that time.
So there is no additional amnesty scheme for companies that has already
as
been
of now, okay. As of now, there is no scheme being provided to the companies that have been struck off.
Do you see anything coming in the future, sir?
I don't see that. I don't see, because the ministry has already issued the notifications and they have issued the letters to those companies. They were which were in default of filing returns with the ROC for a longer period. And the companies, if the companies have already been struck off, no relaxation as of now has been announced. And I don't feel. And I don't expect this is going to happen.
Because even high courts have refused to grant stay on that or provide any relief in that regard.
So, yeah, I know, because earlier what was happening that the companies, for example, I'm having a company and I don't want to run it. That has already been struck off. And I'm having some other company also wherein my DIN is active. And right. I am a director, but my DIN is not active. So in such a case, like one company I don't want to run. That the company is struck off, I'm happy. But right. at the same time, I'm having some other company where I'm running the business. I'm ready to pay tax as well. I'm ready to comply with the requirement, because I have already, we have so much of loss in the previous company that has come to an end. But now we are not in a position to get our DIN to be activated, because High Court has stopped giving the stay on that.
Right.
So now there are many directors that are facing such kind of an issue. They are not able to get their DIN to be activated. So, yes, we have to wait, because till the time, earlier it was happening and DIN used to be getting activated on basis upon the stay order which was being given by the High Court. But now High Court has stopped giving the stay order. So now we need to wait what happens. One of my professional colleague has already filed an application for contempt of court's order, because High Court has given the stay but ROC hasn't activated the DIN. So let's wait for this. If it gets approved, definitely we are just going to next step, which is going to be beneficial for all of us.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sure. Thank you. Pradeep ji, ek aur meri query hai. How can a company file its annual returns of which all the directors are disqualified under section 64? What is the remedy, sir?
So it would be section 164, sir.
164 I am talking about.
Okay, 164. Sir, section 164.
All the directors are disqualified.
Okay. So, if the directors are disqualified under section 164, means they are in a company where the company got already stuck off. So, as I have already explained, if the company has come to an end and the company is not operative and the directors have already been disqualified, in such a case, you need to get your new directors to be appointed by filing the application manually with the concerned registrar of company. mentioning that the existing directors are not active and we are of opinion to run the company. So please allow us so that the company can also file its pending returns or pending whatever requirement comply with the rules. But the existing directors will not be in a position to file the pending returns because their DIN have already been invalid by virtue of Section 164, as you explained.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, those again not related to the relaxations, but if a situation is that there is a closely held company, one by there are only two directors, one wife and one husband, mm-hmm. and unfortunately in this COVID period the husband dies. Mm-hmm. So as per law, the company is not a legal entity and it's not a company anymore because there are no the minimum requirement of directors is not there. Mm-hmm. So how do you advise the company to proceed? Can they appoint a new director in such
definitely
a situation?
In such a case, you will if the husband dies and wife is there, then the wife will be appointing and another person who will be the director of the company in such a case, because a single person in case of a private limited company will not be sufficing the basic requirement, that is of having at least two directors and two shareholders. In such a case, a new person will be appointed as a director who will be complying with the basic requirement of having at least two people on the board. So in case one dies, then another has a right to appoint somebody else as a director.
So is there a time limit for doing so?
Basically, yes, there is a time limit because as per the law, if you are having single person on the board for a consecutive period of 6 months, then the company is mandated for, you know, filing an application for the compulsory winding up. But if you have appointed another person as a director before such period, then you are complying with the law. There is nothing to worry about.
So there is no relaxation in that part of 4 months?
No. There is no relaxation related because there are many points which are practically, which may happen in the scenario. Like as you explained that there are two people, husband and wife, and maybe husband would have died due to corona or some other, you know, reasons. In such a case, yes, the relaxation is very much required to be there. But in such a case, wife has a right to appoint somebody else as a director on the board. And that person will be there on the board and you can, you know, run your business as it was being done earlier.
Sir, if I go more practical to this, of this is that if you have to appoint anybody, you have to take a resignation from the person that who is not there as a director to the board.
But the person, if the person has already died, how will you be able to
Are there enough provisions available so that in such scenario a new director can be appointed, sir?
Yes, definitely. In case of death of the company, if you file, like as I would like to bring it to your attention, that for appointment or change in designation or a cessation of any company, you know, director in the company, you need to file your DIR-12. So when you file your DIR-12, you are filing a cessation of any of the directors. The reasons come, you know, automatically start popping up. So you need to select. There is a reason that death. If the person has come to an end in the company, you know, director has died. So you have to select that and you have to attach the, you know, related document like a death certificate or any other document related to his demise. And in such a case, you can inform the registrar of companies and you don't need to file a resignation, because resignation happens when the person is willing to resign from the company, from the directorship. But now here the condition is entirely different. The company director has died due to reason or whatever. So he is not in a position to give his resignation because he is not in existence as of now.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a wonderful session.
Thank you so much.
Wind up, Kare. I think there is no
question. If someone wants to ask, we can take it up and then we can conclude it. I think Pradeep ji has elaborately detailed whatever the relaxation that have been provided by MCA. We are so grateful to him for sparing us time to present this, sir. So I think, Jeevan, we can end it then.
Yeah, thank you very much, Pradeep ji. Thanks for this wonderful session. I think people have gained on this subject. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sadar, for conducting.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me and giving me this regard that you always gave me, sir. I would like to express my thanks to all of you for getting me into the session and making me an important part of it.
We'll keep bringing you next in the future. Definitely. Also, sir, for other webinars and other sessions related to MCA,
anytime,
the companies.
Anytime, sir. Sure, sir.